I'm really excited to bring you the upcoming interview with a very special guest. You'll hear him discussing all the great and courageous work that he's currently engaged in. And if you feel inspired to help him continue these efforts, please consider making a donation earmarked for his projects. Or feel free to give a general donation that will support the wider movement in Myanmar. Our ongoing support is so helpful and appreciated by the Burmese people during these dark days. Simply go to insightmyanmar.org/donation to contribute today. Or stay tuned to the end of the episode to hear more options. Now, let's hear from that guest himself. I'm really delighted to be joined here by Coco, who is going to tell us a bit about his experience in the protest movement and some firsthand encounters and how he has been involved. So, Coco, I know it's very late there as you're talking to us. I really appreciate you taking the time to be with us here on Insight Myanmar podcast.
Thank you. I'm really grateful for being here today and have the chance to talk with you.
Yeah. So before we get into your last 6 weeks, which I know has been quite chaotic and hectic for you and everyone else, I'd like to learn just a little bit about yourself and your life prior to February 1st. So can you give us a bit of a background about your upbringing and your educational background and everything else leading up to the coup?
Right, of course. My name is Coco, and I'm almost 31 years old now. I am a doctor. I graduated 5-6 years ago, and since I've graduated, I have been working with my dad, who is also a doctor, and in his private clinic in Azerbaijan area for 2-3 years before he passed away. And ever since then, I've been trying to start further my careers by studying abroad. I'm thinking of maybe UK or Australia, and I've been saving up for the exams over there. And then come February 1st, the coup happens, and all of the dreams get just wasted away.
Right. So where were you exactly in your medical training? What point had you gotten up to just within Myanmar?
But I've actually graduated. I am a full-fledged doctor now. But a medical degree in Myanmar is not easily accepted in a Western country or anywhere else in the world, to be perfectly honest. So in order to go work or further our careers in another country, we have to sit for the exams that are designated for specific parts of the globe. For example, for UK, they have PLABS, and for Australia, they have AMC, and for US, I think they have something called US Emily or something. So in order to work there and study further, I have to first pass their tests first. So even though I am a full-fledged doctor over here in Myanmar, I am not so much in other parts of the world.
Right, right. So you graduated from medical school in Myanmar. Had you started any kind of work after in the medical field after your graduation?
Yes. I've worked with closely with my dad. I was studying under his wings before he passed away for 2.5 years in his private clinic.
Right, yeah. I'm sorry about that. To ask just a very general question you must get from other people, why did you want to be a doctor?
Well, as as an Asian, it's sort of like a family pressure, to be perfectly honest. And I was the firstborn, the elder. So there was a lot of hopes and dreams coming into my life and a lot of pressures as well. But that was up until I actually joined the medical school. I actually failed a year over there because it was quite hectic and at first. And it's the educational system that we face in high school and at the medical schools are a huge difference in our country. So I was having a little bit of difficulties there, but actually my dad was kind of like my idol. So he was always encouraging me, even that I failed and I wanted to quit medical school. He was always there to encourage me and bring me up and support me. So I decided to give it another try, even though I failed the second year. And then I just, you know, kept going. And after I graduated and started walking and with my father under his guardianship, that I actually enjoy walking as a doctor. So that's how I started feeling and started walking like a doctor. During all those the studies, it was very tiring, to be perfectly honest. I thought with every opportunity, I thought I was giving up, and I always thought I don't want to become a doctor, and I always thought there was sort of like pressure. You know, I thought I was pressuring into becoming a doctor, but only after graduating and walking with my dad, and I started to know and feel how it feels like to be a doctor and walk as one.
Oh yeah, thank you. I reminds me of how I came from a family of teachers. Both my parents were teachers. And so when I was a kid, obviously the one thing I did not want to do was be a teacher. And somehow life contorted me into going into not just having a job as a teacher, but ended up going into graduate school and having positions very much in education. That's a completely other story that I don't want to sidetrack what you're sharing, but just kind of funny how our family background comes into play as we go through life. And I just also want to emphasize how beautiful that story is with the connection with your dad. And I think with what you're doing now and what you've come to achieve, I'm sure he would just be so proud of you, and that everything that he gave you and how he supported you, what it's leading to what you've been able to do now, even through the hardships you had to pass through. So that's just a really wonderful thing to reflect on. You mentioned that you had a bit of a struggle in getting to become a doctor and in the medical field, but eventually you came around to that. So what is it that you came to enjoy or to find fulfilling about the career once you passed through school?
You mean working as a doctor? Actually, I was walking with my dad on we were walking in a private clinic at the suburban area. The thing about suburban areas is that it's heaps different from the city centers. There people actually the people live over there, they're actually poor, and this is gonna sound something like a fairy tale, but these things are actually happening in a third world country like Myanmar. The villagers actually sort of worship you. You know, I'm not saying I like playing God. It's they worship you. At the same time, they depend on you. They come to you with the hope that they have some kind of illness that is making them feel nauseous or feel totally unwell. And some of these people actually come with very life-changing or life-threatening condition. Like if they going to keep going with this illness, this disease, they are going to feel unwell for the rest of their life, you know, that kind of conditions. And all you have to do is give them regular treatments, the right treatment for the rest of their life, or just a couple of months with that kind of right treatment, they can be right as rain again. They can start to, you know, enjoy life again, especially with diseases like diabetes or kidney diseases. You know, diabetic patients, they outright told my dad, that's what I heard, sometimes they just want to die because they don't feel like living anymore. It's like they can't eat anything that is sweet. The staple food in Myanmar is rice, and a lot of these villagers have been eating rice all of their life. They just can't live without it. So not being able to eat carbohydrates, which is essentially rice here, is very damaging to their life. And this sometimes they just say outright, "Is there any way that I can revert this? And is there any way that I can, that would make them feel alive again?" And my dad, one of the diabetic patient himself, is very supportive, and he's sort of like what I call is a naughty professor, because he has this way around with a way with his patients, and especially with the diabetic patients. He just, sometimes he's strict with them. Sometimes he's just, give them a little breathing space, like, "Okay, your sugar is a little high this visit, so I'm going to restrict your diet for a while. You have to listen to me. Take this medicine, just as I say, and within would come next visit, and if everything goes well, I might let you have, let's say, an ice cream as a treat." And somehow it's like these villagers are so innocent, and somehow it works with them every time. It's like, watching him kind of nurture people in there. It doesn't actually feel like a clinic anymore. It's like people come in, they just talk, sometimes they have a laugh, and they just do their things. And it's somehow strikes me that this profession can actually help people. It's like, carrying them back from the verge of depressions or things like that, especially when he is treating mental illness, which is considered taboo in our country. People rarely speak out about their mental illness. They just don't want to be called crazy. But whenever my dad is treating a mentally ill patient too, he's very friend and very considerate. He even tell the family that mental illness is not to be joke about and not to keep secret. And he's always upfront with them. And I really liked about the fact he's open and very caring about his patient. That's what I learned from him. And that's when I started, enjoy being a doctor.
So it sounds like he had a really good bedside manner.
Even though he's a naughty
That's
professor, as my mom would call it. Yeah.
great. So you learned from one of the best in the professions, who also happened to be your own father. So that's really beautiful how that all worked out. So you were on this path of trying to continue your medical education overseas when the coup broke on February 1st. And can you walk us through what it was like that first day and the following week when you were just coming to grips with the fact that a very new and unexpected reality had just taken place?
Right. It was a surprise, nonetheless. But actually, all of us were a actually expecting this. No, not expecting. We know it might happen, because the junta and the military have been telling on social medias and even to the news medias that they might do this. They say they're always, they were saying that there isn't anything they're not going to do in order to save the country, in their words, So we knew something like this could happen, but what we didn't account it for was we didn't know they would be stupid enough in this time and age to actually, do the coup. So it was on the February 1st, I was woken up by my mom around like 8 in the morning, and the first thing my mom told me was, "They've done it." And I was like, "Who've done what?" And my mom was like, "The coup. They actually did it." And I was like, "Are you sure?" And my little brother came in, and yeah, that he calls me Morty. So Morty, yeah, it really happened. You can check your phone. And I tried to use my phone, and there was no internet. I was like, "There's no internet." And he said, "Exactly." So there was no internet, and there was nothing on the TV, nothing on the TV, no channels, no national TV, and nothing on the radio either. all we could do was call each other. And even then, some of the operators are off, the lines were busy. So that's when we realized these things have actually happened, because this total media blackout, it couldn't have happened without the coup. So we were like, yeah, okay, so all we can do right now is just sit and wait for the news, what actually happened and who got arrested and who got away. So we just have to wait for the news. So then the bad news came, and all of the top position, our state councilor, our presidents got detained, but they were safe. So that was a relief. That was that. And nobody could, we were shocked. We were a little bit surprised, but we were shocked. So nobody actually went out there on the street yet. We just sit in our homes and wait for the news. So what we should do or what would happen next.
Right. So that's a really good accounting for just the initial shock of those first few hours and first few days. So then what happened next? Because we know from the news that and from what you just said, that the people did not go out in the streets right away, but eventually that did happen. So what started to happen after the news really sunk in after a few days? What was happening in the streets and what were you doing personally?
Right. So it was around the afternoon. We started to get our internet connections back, and everything was confirmed. So there it is. The coup is here. So we were like brainstorming, okay, what to do, and people were panicking. Some of the people think, should I start stocking up food now? Like there was a lot of panicking over there, like over here. There was no signs of protest yet, because we had very little time, and during the shock, we don't know how to respond appropriately either. But then again, you know, a news started and information started flowing, and I don't know who started it, but it says we have to wait for like 72 hours and wait and see what actually happens and how to respond to it. Some of them said it's sort of like a psyop from the other, you know, the military side, that it's kind of like an operation that that they made, that we have actually accepted the coup, and they want to show the world that nobody is rioting or nobody is protecting out in the street even after 72 hours, you know, even within the 72 hours. So I think they were going to show these images of people being peaceful and sort of like perpetrate like we welcome or we accepted the coup or that kind of thing. But personally, I think it somehow plays into our strength. Because during the 72 hours, a lot of us had the time to like really sit down, discuss and brainstorm ideas on what to do next, you know, instead of going out there on the street and protesting. We had the chance to sit down and discuss what to do next. And there were a lot of ideas flying around, and we accepted this one thing, the CDM movement, like civil disobedient movement. A lot of people would start suggesting it, and because we are totally not familiar with any kinds of weapons or firearms at all, and given the history lessons, these hunters and their armed thugs are not above shooting anyone who go out there and, you know, protest right now. So we have to think hard and carefully about how we would respond. And we came up with this CDM movement, which have a lot of evidence that it could work. So we thought we were going to try this. And a lot of the doctors started to join in, and they speak out that we were going to do this CDM movement. This is soft power, and this soft power has the ability and the evidence strong enough in the past to actually defeat this hard power people. So we said, okay, so this is the only thing that is tangible and credible, and we should do this. So we decided to give it a try. And so the first 72 hours go by, we were trying to collect people and how to actually do it. And then again, CDM movement, when we started the CDM movement, there were also another part of doctors and people who thought we were going to start with the Red Ribbon Movement. Now, at the same time, Red Ribbon Movement is more like CDM, but the thing is, they still goes to these hospital, you know, that hospital that they're working, this government hospital. They will still provide care to the patients, you know, so that the government hospital will still be running, but they will be wearing a red ribbon on their body or on the chest or somewhere to show the fact that they do not support the coup and they are actually against it. And there were a lot of debates for like a week whether or not Red Ribbon Movement would work, because the junta, they couldn't care less if we wear or not wear anything on our body, as long as we are working for them and the country is still running. So after a week of really debating and discussion, these Red Ribbon Movement people are starting to slowly join the CDM movement. That's how we decided to do it. And after, as soon as the 72-hour was over, people start to, you know, start going out in the street, start protesting. There was this one very famous doctor from Mandalay. I forgot his name. I'm really sorry about this. He was the one who actually started protesting. The protests actually started in Mandalay. He started there, and a lot of people think he was some sort of like, sort of like a spy, or, you know, the military people, we thought, because a lot of people were into the fact that we're not going to protest, we're just going to do the CDM movement and see how that goes. So there were some people who think going out in the street and protesting are part of the military plan, and, you know, giving them the chance to shoot at us, you know, something like that. There was a lot of confusion going on back that time.
Right. So you're describing this kind of chaotic period where the people, and especially the doctors, are trying to figure out how to respond. Do the doctors follow CDM, where they refuse to go to the hospitals and to work for the government in any capacity? I should say work for the military in any capacity. Or do they go to the hospitals because they want to care for the patients, but to show that they are not supportive of the military regime, they are wearing a red ribbon to signify that they're fulfilling their duties, but they're not they do not believe they want to work under this new regime. And as all these decisions are being made and people are trying to figure out what to do, what I'm curious, as you mentioned, as you were describing, you know, we were thinking this, or we were talking about this, and I'm wondering who we was. Of course, I don't want you to identify any names of actual people. It's more what I'm curious about is the decision-making process. So this has all happened all of a sudden. People are suddenly talking in their networks to try to figure out what to do. People have different opinions. Communication is a little bit difficult. So generally speaking, I'm just wondering, among the doctor community, and as you're having this conversation, you're engaged with different people, how is the decision-making process going for determining, coming down with a very, very high-stakes decision of how you're going to respond, and having to correspond with different people in different places and somehow reach some kind of consensus?
Well, as luck would have it, before the coup, there was COVID-19, right? So doctors are actually quite well connected at that time when coup actually happened. We all of us have to, you know, come in and bring strong about COVID-19. There were a lot of volunteers working with us, non-medical people, you know, volunteering for the COVID relief things. So we are quite well connected at that time. And there were vaccines coming in too. So we were discussing about the proficiency and efficacy of vaccines as well online. So it was just a coincidence, but we were quite well connected with each other. And of course, we have our Facebook groups, but we rarely talk there anymore. But still, we have a lot of Facebook groups for doctors with, you know, same years, same graduated years and such. So everyone talk, And we just, Facebook is the king here. So we just, you know, spread the ideas up on the Facebook and the groups and the messengers as well. And that's actually how it started, in my opinion. And another thing is, because of COVID-19, there were a lot of volunteers from the doctor part, from the medical field. And we didn't actually have enough personal protective equipment or PPE to handle the cases. So even with the cases, even with less equipment and things, doctors were actually courageously fighting off COVID-19 on the front lines. So as luck would have it, people are actually rooting and supporting the doctors because they are portrayed as heroes in this time of need during this pandemic. So when things started and the doctors say, we are going to do this CDM movement, and we discuss on our Facebook groups and other social media platforms and other, you know, secret groups as well. So when we actually do this and decided this could work and we're gonna do this, and we posted it on social medias and announced, okay, we're gonna do this. We this have the evidence in the past to actually worry against this junta and the military armed dogs. So everyone actually just, you know, followed through without. Some of them without even knowing what CDM actually is, but like 70% of the people know what CDM actually is and how it works. About the 30% of the people don't really know what CDM is, but doctors are doing it, and a lot of the other peoples are joining to fight against the junta. So we are united against a common enemy, and that's how it started. That's my opinion, yes.
Right, right. So the first week you're describing the doctors being on the forefront of the CDM movement and you actually personally being in the middle of this as well, of deciding what you're going to do, of coordinating. And you have these networks that are set up based on the COVID response of the past year. So there's ways to have this easy communication. And so even before the general populace and even some of the doctors themselves have an understanding of what CDM is, these guys in the medical profession are at the forefront of creating a movement that would now come to define the entire six-week uprising up to this point. That leads us only to the first week. Things have been moving very fast. So after this CDM movement starts to happen among the doctors, walk us through what happens next for those in the medical profession. What, after the CDM movement starts taking off, what is the next involvement or concern that doctors start to think about?
Well, when we decided to do the CDM movement, there were still doctors in the medical field who are closely related to people with military background, or has a dad as soldier or a general, or, you know. So we have to think about that too, because these people could be potential spies, and we believe they are not above selling us off to the junta if, you know, push comes to shove. So we have to do this in secret. So we have to discuss everything in secret. And that's how this underground connection, the network of a doctor, actually started. But at this, one of the doctors who is a friend during the medical school actually called me through one of the secret apps, and he told me that they're actually starting an underground group. More might join in later, and they want to have a connection throughout the country, because there are towns and cities where there are a lot of military influences, and they are less, their city with less influence, just like Yangon. So in order to support them physically, you know, financially and psychologically, we thought we have to keep, you know, get in connection, get connected with everyone else, and actually ask how they're doing and what are their plans. So we thought we have to coordinate somehow, and that's how we they started, some of the really young doctors started this network, and I had the chance, the opportunity to join them. Actually, I wasn't I wasn't actually a government doctor. In our times, we call it in-service doctor. So even though I am a strong CDM supporter, I am not a CDM doctor. I'm just a private doctor who works outside, not for the government. So I thought you know, I could help them in a way or two, because these people working for the government, these real CDM doctors, could be in danger, whereas I am not, because the government doesn't actually have my address or my phone number, so I can move more freely than they are. So I thought, hey, yeah, so they trust me enough to put me in this network. And so if I can help them, you know, I can help them financially, or, you know, even if they have one accommodation or, you know, a place to hide. Because we were pretty sure if we are going to do this, we have to hide at some point, you know, go into hiding and do this in secret nonetheless. So we thought these things would happen and how it would affect our lives. So we started doing this network and started helping the doctors, you know, not just doctors, everyone in medical fields. Like there were also nurses in there, and there are also labor workers who are walking, you know, at the janitors, and everyone who work at the hospital. They started joining in on the CDM too, so we have to care for them. And a lot of these doctors are somewhat financially stable at this point, so we were giving priority whenever it comes to financial support. We were giving priorities to the nurses and these janitors and others, basic level workers, because they are the one that needs care and support more so than ever. And it's actually pay off. We are always trying to prioritize their livelihood and well-being and financial support. And at the same time, when Honda started arresting these doctors illegally, and, you know, they just broke your door down and just storm in and started arresting these CDM doctors, they were the ones, these people living in the hospital compound are the ones who actually try and protect these doctors, CDM doctors. So we were helping each other in our own way.
Yeah, that's beautiful. That sounds incredible. You have people of all different kinds of professional echelons and people inside and outside that are supporting. Roughly speaking, what percentage would you say of people in government hospitals are now have joined CDM?
I would say around 70%, if not 80. I think it could be around 70%. But we are gaining more and more people to join CDM movement even now. 70% is roughly for medical personnel only. There are some people who are not doing CDM. I don't know, whatever their reason is, military backgrounds or somewhat. And we have heard every now and then that these people actually have the gall to try and open up all of the hospital again. I think just recently, just last week, the military has announced that Manly General Hospital has opened up again and started welcoming patients, but nobody goes. And we, this is just like a facade. We all know this. Nobody can actually run the General Hospital in Manly, which is the largest hospital in Manly, with just, what, 20 people? No, they can't actually do that. But that is somehow sort of like tricking the people into thinking that CDM has actually failed. And they're doing that in a lot of the friends too. So yeah, I think 70% of the doctors have actually joined.
Right. And that's why it's so great to be able to talk to you and people like you who are able to go behind these fake reports and pictures and give us the real story of what's happening. And I also appreciate how, when you're describing the CDM movement, you're not just talking about the higher level doctors with many years experience and positions. You're talking about the nurses, the janitors, everyone involved in every aspect of the hospital operation, and how people are working together, how people are those who are not so much in need or not requiring assistance. So those that need the need can have it, whether it's people stepping up for financial need, for protection, for hiding CDM workers or their family or ferrying them away. I'm curious about what those financial needs are. As you know, we do now have a way to collect donations and bring them into the CDM movement. And at the end of our interview, we'll also be sharing that information with listeners, and they can give a donation to support the general movement, or they can earmark it for your work specifically. So I think it's good to have a better idea of actual numbers that you're working with to be able to support those in the medical field who are taking this courageous decision to be able to leave their work despite all the risks inherent in that and to join CDM. Roughly speaking, can you give us any idea of, for, and I know it must differ quite a bit with someone's position and family and other necessities and such, but can you give us any general idea of how people are supported when they choose to step away from the medical field and join CDM?
Well, we are actually doing whatever we can, but we have these local distribution groups. We decided to do this because Honda has started to arrest all of the celebrities and influencers and all of the foundations, organizations that were openly supporting CDM has the capacity to rally the people, influence the people, and the organization that have the financial background to actually back and support the CDM movement. So they have arrested a lot of the influencers and a lot of the organization founders as well. So we thought we can't just make a big group. And we were going to divide into smaller groups and try to support the local people, you know, like local medical related personnel in their areas. And that's how they can safely go from one place to another and support them financially or otherwise. At first, we were like, we started getting funds from a lot of the doctors and other people as well. So we decided to go to them personally at first and ask them what they actually need. If that is money, yes, we will provide them with money. And if it is not, or it's just, you know, daily necessities like rice or oil or other cooking necessities and food, yes, we will give them that. So it was the fact that we agreed upon. And some of the people, they just asked for the financial support because they still have the luxury and the opportunity to go out there and still shop and buy their own food and stuff. And there are other people who have to go deep into hiding or not, you know, quite close to the markets, or they have their own problems, so they just ask for food supplies or, you know, something like that, which is actually happening with the railway worker. Since the railway workers started joining the CDM movement, they were like thousands of people in there in this single compound with their families and everything. So they didn't ask for financial support. They just asked for food that could last for months during the CDM movement. So that's exactly what people did. So we did the same thing for our medical personnel too.
Right. Yeah. Okay. So it just depends on the need of the person and what you're able to provide. And in terms of your own fund and resources, do you have sufficiency for being able to support those who are taking that risk by stepping down and joining CDM?
At first, it was one of the concern as well. That's why we try to list the people and prioritize people who actually needs the support the most from the ground up. So a lot of the doctors, like 99% of the doctors, didn't actually need any kind of support except for a place to hide or stay for a moment. So that was that. And aside from that, we actually try to help the other that are in dire need first. But that was before CRPH our real government and step in. There was during the first month of coup, there was a lot of problem, and a lot of the elected, formerly elected people were on the run. So they didn't actually have the luxury of forming a temporary government yet. So now we call that CRPH. So they were on the run, so it was very chaotic. But once they form a temporary government, CRPH's appointed minister, which is our orthopedic professor, and once he become a professor, becomes the minister, he decided he will do the he will handle all of this supporting group, and he will start to financially support all of these and all the help that they can, so that they started trying to get a list. But even then, there was a lot of confusions and fears that you know, people were afraid the emails that he had provided on the social media, are they the real ones? What if these emails got hacked and they got the list? Are we going to be arrested? And there was a lot of fears. We have to actually go through that fear for like a week, and a lot of reassurance going into there to you know, just sure, just making sure people just started giving him the list, because without the list, these CRPH can actually started, you know, going, started, you know, circulating all the fundings and stuff. So there was a lot of confusions and a lot of work too. But I'm just a grunt, a supporter, a helper, so I don't really know how it went down.
Right. So let's take us along this pathway of the medical response. We've covered a bit of how the doctors were involved in CDM. What was the next activity or involvement that doctors and medical workers began to engage in as the protests started to progress?
Well, even though they are on the run, these CDM doctors, a lot of my friends are CDM doctors. Even though they, some of them even have a warrant on their head, and especially in, I think, at Chin and Kachin region, they actually posted the headshot of these people and doctors and people who are doing the CDM movement. You can see them out on the street, posted by the junta. Even though they sort of have a warrant out there and their names are out there, they have been actually joining the walking protests, and they're also supporting and helping out with the other CDM people from other fields as well. And before all of these chaos and violence, we actually try to provide medical covers for the protester too. You know, they, back in the day when there were thousands of people on the street, like a sea of humans or sea of people out in the street, as you would see on the 2222 movement or something. We tried to provide medical cover for them. Things were a bit more peaceful, a lot peaceful than right now. But once the shooting had started, we tried to give more care and more medical cover for these people as much as we can. A lot of these CDM doctors are actually helping with the medical cover right now.
Right. So as the protests started to progress, a lot of these doctors and medical workers were actually going out into the streets to assist the expected violence that would come, including those doctors, as you mentioned, that had warrants out for them, whose headshots were being circulated. So they were taking even greater risks. What was it like for those doctors? And maybe you personally have experience, or you've heard from your colleagues who have. What was it like for those doctors who were going out into the protests to care for the nonviolent protesters fearing violence?
Just like I said, at first it was a bit peaceful. The only things we had to treat was bruise and scrapes and muscle cramps. And then suddenly, bam, one day, and people started getting shot all over the places. Started off with rubber bullets, tear gases. And suddenly, you know, one day they were started using a live ammunition openly out in the open. They weren't actually holding back anymore. So at first, we we have already expected this. We also discuss in the group, we talk to their friends, and every time we go out for a medical cover, you may have seen it on social media, like we write our blood group and the emergency contact phone number on our arms, you know, like who to call, and this is my blood type in case we get shot. It's sort of like going to war. So every time we do that, we jokingly say to each other, okay, so is this the day that we are going to get shot or somebody's going to get shot? And we just, you know, joke each other. But it came to reality one day that people started getting shocked. And even though we were expecting this, we were shocked to a degree. And a lot of my friends said, who actually been at the place of incidents, they actually said that it was horrifying, and there was a lot of blood everywhere, and it was nothing like on the operation table or anything that we have ever seen before. And these are coming from people that have already dealt with death on a daily basis at a government hospital or private hospital, but these things are like hella different. The thing that they've seen, the violence and all the cries and scream that they've seen, they say this is what hell might look like or sounds like, and they're like, okay, this is a gunshot wound now. Okay, this is a gunshot wound. So what am I gonna do? What am I gonna do? What am I gonna do? And like, at that point, they say was all I could do was just pull a tourniquet out and put a rubber band above the gunshot wound, and that was it. That was the only thing that I could do. And they were shocked for like 3 seconds there, and that nobody know what to do. We actually prepare for this. We have online seminars on how to deal with ballistic injuries and gunshot wounds. But when you see it up front, like right in front of your face, like everyone's shocked. We don't know what to do. It's like there are a lot of bleeding. So normally we will try and, you know, stop the bleeding. But when it is gunshot wound, we're like, okay, this is real. We're getting shot now. So everyone's like stunned for like 3 seconds, and then said, okay, so stop the bleeding. And they started pulling out their tourniquets and they do their things. And all they could do was send them off to a like real hospital where they can actually do an actual, you know, actual surgery. And more often than not, these soldiers were actually shooting to kill. So not a lot of tourniquets were actually used, to be perfectly honest. You may have seen it on social medias that the people, these armed thugs, were aiming for the head. And we can't actually put a tourniquet on a headshot wound. And that was at the start where we could actually collect the body and with the gunshot wound to the head. And lately we can't even collect the bodies anymore. It's like they're not even allow anyone to come near the body, and whenever everything's cools down, they just drag the body away and they just outright dispose of the body. Like they burn it. It's on the medias now. They just burn it without the permission of the family, and there's just a short notification or a phone call to the family like, yeah, your son or your daughter is dead now, so we are going to cremate him. And that was it. That as so much as not nothing so much as a goodbye or anything. That's what they're doing right now, and that's the reality that we're dealing with.
Yeah, it's stunning, and it's really a terrorist organization that is not holding anything sacred, any kind of norms that even in the hardest of conditions you often find. So going back to how you described how the doctors and the medical staff were dealing with those injuries that they could actually try to treat, a couple of follow-up questions there. So first, when they're in the street, having some kind of makeshift tent or something where they're treating people, what kinds of resources and facilities do they have available? Is it adequate for what they're dealing with? And second, you mentioned follow-up question to that one, if they're going into hospitals for the more serious ones, how are they able to have access to those hospitals? Are those state hospitals that they're able to go in? Do they have to sneak in? Are there more resources in there? What are the doctors and medical staff able to do to bring resources to bear for those who need it, who have sustained injury?
Well, every single one of us who are going to go out in a medical cover, we have a list. We call it a short list for emergency, and there's also a long list for emergency. Whereas, you know, we bring bandages, tourniquets, and, you know, something to stop the bleeding, all these injections and sutures and needles and whatnot, like an emergency bag we have together with us. And we have a lot of, we have, you know, some nurses, like a couple of nurses that will help us along with whatever that emergency might be needed. And there are also volunteers who, you know, strong men who can actually carry the patients from one person to the one place to the next. So at first we were going out with ambulances, and we tried to find a place not so far away from the protest, like when there was used to be a lot of a huge protest area. So we tried to stay quite close, but not too far from the area of protest, and treat whatever illness they may have. And when shooting started, at first, we were like, okay, so we are medics. We are doctors. We are medics. So we are also wearing this scrub, and we have these symbols, like a Red Cross. But not like the Red Cross, not like the organization Red Cross, but, you know, as some symbol representing that we are medics and volunteers. So we thought we'd be safe, you know, at a distance like this. And if we are not in the immediate line of fire, we thought we'd be safe because we're medics, and nobody would be bad enough to shoot at us. At first, we were like, okay, if the gunshot or, you know, any kinds of wound is to the protester, yeah, we're gonna save them. You know, we're gonna give treatment. And if that is from the other side, if the other side is also injured, we are also under oath. Ethically, we have to give treatment to the other side as well. So, but, you know, even though we didn't actually want to, but ethically, it was the ethical things to do. So, so we started off with something like that. And then when, you know, things get intense and violence erupt, then these people doesn't discriminate. They just shoot at ambulances too. They shoot at ambulances. They even, you know, go into medical tents. There are CCTV footages in not Yangon, but other parts of the country where there were medics and volunteers sitting peacefully inside a medical tent covered at the front. There was an ambulance over there at the front, you know, covering the tent so that they were covered from the line of fire. They were sitting peacefully inside the tent and attending to the patient. These thugs just went straight into the tent and just started beating the crap out of, you know, everyone on site, you know, whether it is medic or doctors or volunteers. They just don't care. And when they were beating the crap out of them, they were always aiming for the head. I don't know what's wrong with these people, but everything they do, they just aim for the head. There was hitting these on this one particular CCTV footage. He was beating the crap out of this young volunteer boy in the head until his nose started bleeding. And after that, they just, you know, put them into the jail car and arrested them. We actually didn't know what the follow-up story was. There was a lot of story back then. And that's when we started to realize that, okay, we need to hide. Even though we are doctors and medics, we can't be on the spot. Not being in the line of fire is not enough for us to be safe. So we started to retreat into somewhere secluded. And we started giving information to each other only when it is necessary. We have this private hospital or clinics that have openly told us, the doctors, that they're going to help with the police cases, you know, just like getting shots and whatnot. And they told us outright they are going to help with these injuries. So we only take these patients to these hospitals and perform surgeries. We still have some government hospital that are still operating without the influence of the military junta yet. So we still have access to the emergency rooms and the operations room over there. And we're having less and less control over what hospital we can use, since military have set up camps and or try to set up camps in a lot of these government hospitals during last month.
Right, right. So you're describing this horrendous situation where not only medical workers and doctors are not being protected, but in some cases they're actually being targeted. We've seen images of ambulances riddled with bullet holes. We've seen medical volunteers dragged out of tents and beaten to death on CCTV, some of the hardest footage I've ever seen. We've seen other medical volunteers take shots to the head far away from snipers. And so you've had to respond as a medical profession by, as you put it to me before this interview, going rogue. Those were your words, that these doctors and you have had to go rogue in terms of being undercover and performing your duties. And when you describe this to me, the thing that came to my mind is going back to my personal history. So my grandfather served in World War II in the American Army, and he served as a conscientious objector, which meant that he was a pacifist. He refused to carry a weapon. He refused to injure another person. Those were his idealistic beliefs at the time. And because of that, he was trained to be, he was drafted, he had no choice, but he was trained to be a medic. So he wore the Red Cross sign that showed that he was a medic. And even as people in his unit were injured and targeted and in fights, he was safe. He was able to administer to them, to use his training. He actually told me that at one point he delivered the baby of a German woman who was going into labor. That was his duty. And my grandfather is Jewish. And so I'm reflecting on the irony that my Jewish grandfather was safe in Nazi Germany in World War II for performing his duties, because there were certain conventions that even the Nazis respected during that time. And you're describing a situation where the terrorism and the assault that you're facing from your own people are more egregious than a Jewish medic in Nazi Germany in World War II. And that's just stunning to me. I don't have words to be able to understand how jarring that contrast is.
Right. It's really horrifying on the ground level. And yes, just like the word we said, we have decided to gone rogue. And that's the only way we could actually help out people here. And that's the method we've been using ever since.
Right, right. And so when you're talking about the resources that you have, are you able to have adequate supplies, or are there things that you're in need of and that you're hoping to get through some kind of import or donation?
Right now, we can still make do. There are a lot of organization who are trying to help out with our supplies and whatnot. So we are still hanging on. We are not under supply just yet. But if there's a food scale war would break out, and it could become a whole other story though.
So one thing I'd also like to ask you about is your own personal direct experience within the protest movement. We've talked a little bit about overall what's happening with the greater movement, what other people are doing in terms of strategies. But I'd really like to take a moment and just check in with you, with how you're doing, how you're feeling, what it actually feels like to be on the front lines. Because some of the listeners, as they're getting these stories and pictures and even videos, they still don't really translate into giving an idea or feeling of what it's actually like in person to suddenly be leaving what's normal society and stepping in to a nonviolent protest where there could be violence on the other side, and minute by minute, day by day, to be in that crowd and that culture and that feeling. So can you give our audience some idea of what it actually feels like to go out and be on the streets?
Well, I'm going to be perfectly honest with you here. I'm 30 years old, and I have seen what the Generation Z out in the street have not seen and have not heard of. I know what the older generation, like the older Generation Y and Generation X, have seen and heard of. So I'm going to be honest with you. I was actually afraid to go out on the street. Call me a hypocrite. I was actually persuading people to join the CDM movement, you know, put themselves forward. But actually, I was afraid to go out on the street at first. But one of my friends was very active. He was one of those few people who go right out in the street the very first day when people go out in the street to protest. And what he told me was, at that time, there were a lot of news and activities on Facebook and social media. You know, people sort of exaggerate things online, like, okay, people are getting shot now, and, you know, heads are being cut off, and there are grenades and whatnot, and there are bloods everywhere. You know, a lot of news like that on Facebook, and a lot of those things were not true. They were all fake or exaggerated in a way. So what he told me was, dude, you gotta, you know, stop being online so much, you know, just stop and just come with me, you know, out in the street and see what it's actually like. So I thought, I'm gonna do it. I've been, you know, persuading people to join the CDM and put them in danger, so it's only natural that I should also put myself out there too. So the first day that I went out, it was back in the day, you know, when protests were peaceful and, you know, no violence back then. And it was actually peaceful back then. You know, people were, the protesters were actually trying to make peace and become friendly with the security forces. Back then, they were offering the police food and water bottles, you know, just not, you know, handing them out. They just, you know, put it in front of police forces and say, okay, these water bottles are for you. We're just here to make friends. We're just here to, you know, tell the world our side of the story. We're just here to protest. We're not going to be violent. And the police were, actually, they didn't say anything, but it was okay back then. There were no shooting or anything. And so I just, you know, started going out there with sometime with him, sometimes, you know, just alone and joining the general areas of the gathering where there are a lot of protesters. And then, you know, one day came and they started, you know, shooting rubber bullets and stun grenades and things. And it was actually very scary. I took a break like on the weekend. And on this one Monday, when I decided to go out again, I've been hearing news on Facebook that they have actually decided to become violent. I mean, the security forces, they were trying to violently disperse the crowd and handling the situation. So what I did was I had to buy all these protective equipments like goggles and fire-resistant gloves in order to put out the tear gases and, you know, maybe throw that away, just like in the movies. Never actually had the chance to do that, though. So the first time I was there, and I was so ready. You know, I sort of felt like a Power Ranger at that point. Okay, I'm ready. I got my goggles on, I got my mask on, and I was like, okay, you know, just throw it to me. I'm gonna do this shit. And when things starts to happen, when they start firing and using the stun grenades, and this is the very first time in my life that I have actually hear this gun firing, and I wasn't actually sure it was rubber bullets or live ammunition or whether it was stun grenades or not. The thing was it was very loud, and the first time I hear it is like bam 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 bam, and I was like, I almost pissed my pants, to be perfectly honest. And I almost ran, and instead of running, I just sat down, because at that time my legs can actually carry me to anywhere. So I just dropped down on my knees and tried to breathe normally. And it wasn't like in the movies where, you know, everything slows down and you think clearly. No, it wasn't like that. You know, everything was so fast. You know, people were running. There was a lot of loud noises everywhere. Everything was so chaotic. And I just sat down on my knee and I thought to myself, okay, so this is it now. We're getting shot at. I don't know with what, but what am I going to do? What am I going to do? And then I looked to my side and I looked to my friend, and what I saw was just people almost half my age. And some of them are actually girls. I'm going to use the word girls here because they aren't women. They're even, you know, almost 18, or some are not even 18. They look so young, like maybe 15 or 16 years old. Girls and boys, they were actually, you know, ready to face what was coming to them. They have this war face on them, you know, stern face on them, carrying a water bag, ready to put out any tear gas coming their way. And my friend was the she bearers. Some are even smaller than me in size and looks a lot younger than me. And they were all ready to do what they were, you know, what they came here to do. And I was here letting fear took over me. So I just thought to myself, okay, so this is not how you're going to win this fight. So you have to calm yourself down. People a lot younger than you are fighting this war. This is your war too, so you have to do this. And so I tried to do it, you know, I tried to get back and try to get into position. And I sort of let a couple of tear gases fly past over me a couple of times. And then, you know, I tried to realize what was happening and how to actually do that. And, you know, putting out the tear gases, helping them out. And when the bulldozer came in to actually destroy the barricade, these shield bearers start to retreat slowly back into the street. We just slowly go back and retreat, and while trying to throw away and put out any tear gases we can find. That's how we did things on the street.
Okay, so you're describing like a really vivid moment by moment description of what it's like to step into a really foreign situation, unlike any you faced, and just have to adapt to this new reality, to the danger, everything else. And one of the things you mention is that you just have to find this inner calm somehow of all this chaos and potential violence and trained military and weaponry, noise, smells that are coming at you. And you somehow have to respond from a place of calm for your own safety. I understand theoretically the importance of that, but doing it is a completely different story. So how did you go about trying to achieve that inner calm when you really weren't calm on the outside?
Well, yeah, just like I said, I was looking at this kid, you know, fighting for what they believe in, and, you know, I'm trying to win back their freedom. And when I actually had this chance to talk with a few of them, especially with the actual, you know, frontline shield bearers and kids, and I asked them, okay, so I was scared, shitless. So how was your first time like, and, you know, how long have you been here? And they were like, what they said was actually they were very supportive. It's really normal to felt this way the very first time. And they said it's normal. What you have to do is just, you know, keep coming back, because the very first time you felt it's going to be out of the world, there's nothing you have ever seen, you know, ever heard of or ever felt, and it's okay to be scared. But what you have to do is you have to, you know, try to get used to it, build up this resistance and to all these noises and all these feelings and all these things that is happening around you. And what they actually said was, they didn't actually feel fear. You know, when fear overtook me, what they felt was, you know, like pure rage. They were angry. What they said was they were angry. It was rage and bloodthirstiness that took them over. You know, even though they were at the front line, you know, holding the shields, all they was thinking was they just want to go up and, you know, just get up and just run into the crowd and give the security forces a piece of their mind. And that's all they wanted to do the very first time. But what they said was, and at that time, they look on their sides and their shield comrades too, and they some of them, you know, ask themselves, they told them to ask themselves, okay, so we're here, we're doing this. So if we get up and fight now, we are 100% sure we are not going to win. And there isn't, you know, much that we can do to win this fight. So what they asked was, do we want to fight or do we want to win? And they said the answer was very clear to them that they don't want to fight right now, not physically anyway. So what they wanted was they wanted to win. They wanted to win this war, not just this battle. So that's how they find their calmness. And that's how they have been, you know, out on the street every day, you know, holding the shields, being closest to the danger. And yet they have never broken any formations or anything. That's how these kids have been, you know, handling this situation.
That's incredible. Yeah, that's really incredible. So basically these kids are going from just living normal lives like kids anywhere in the world without having ever faced any of this in their life outside of a video game. And then they approach these barricades and they're overwhelmed by fear. And then that fear turns to rage. And then that rage turns to some kind of calm calculation that they want to win. And this rage is not going to help them win. So then they learn how to fall into formation and follow some kind of discipline and go about some kind of unit decision-making process of what the best way forward is to achieve those aims. And this is all happening before our eyes kind of day after day. So for you personally, did you start to fall into a similar pattern of going through a similar cycle of from fear to rage to a bit of a detached calculation, or what was the process like for you?
Similar. It took a few days for me to actually settle down too. So at first, just like I said, I was so scared at first, but, as I'm not actually at the very front line. So, what I had to handle and my duty wasn't that big. I was just, you know, putting out tear gases and be a lookout and, you know, look for an escape plan. I actually draw up my escape plan, you know, like where to run when things get worse, something like that. So, but the thing was, these security forces, they try to, you know, drive you back into the street, into the streets, like out on the, you know, main road, into the smaller streets, and they were very rude about it. You can even hear them yelling and swearing and screaming. They were even taunting these protesters too, and they even use a slingshot to shoot at you. So when we retreat back into the streets, the residents of all of these streets open their doors to welcome us, you know. So we sort of disperse and hide into these apartments, and most of the time, security forces just stop at the start of the street. They don't usually go in because they are actually scared that people might start, you know, throwing things from the balconies and or from the upper floor. So if they don't have the number to go into the street, they don't do that. They are very clever that way, really cheeky bastards. So they just, you know, wait out in the street, try to taunt the people and, you know, swearing at people. And what they did was they actually, you know, break mirrors and glasses of nearby cars. They were, you know, kicking and shouting. And some of them even, you know, tear the tires of trishaws and cars and bicycles or anything nearby. They just destroy everything that they see, and they're taunting and swearing at us. So yes, if you ask me if my fear turns into rage just like these kids, yes, I whenever they were doing something like that, I just, you know, just want to go out there and give them a piece of my mind. But it's not a clever thing to do. So I have to control myself. And after 2 or 3 days, you sort of, you know, just got into it. Now, if they taunt you, you just sort of taunt back. If you're sure, if I'm sure, if I'm at a safe enough place. But more often than not, we don't do that because most of the time when we go out and protest, it's not our place of residence. It's not our streets, not per se. So we don't want to put the residences in danger. So whenever they're taunting, whenever they're destroying things, we just keep our mouth shut and just took it. so that we don't put the residents of the nearby streets and apartments into more danger.
Right, right. So these guys are just bullies. I mean, you're just describing these guys are just fucking bullies out in the street, just, you know, like any, you know, any mentality of any bully you find anywhere that are just engaging in wanting to puff themselves up by being able to, you know, to push anyone around in any way they're able to get away with. Yeah, right. So I want to take a moment to describe some of this rage that you're talking about and how you're working with it, especially in the context of what has so far been a nonviolent movement. Of course, we're talking on March 22nd, so by the time people listen to this, things might have changed, but up till now, it has been a thoroughly nonviolent movement. And even as this rage is overtaking you and overtaking others, out of a detached calculation of how to win overall, this nonviolent ethos is remaining. So I want to ask a couple questions about that. So first, just examining your own personal sense of rage and how you're understanding it and working with it. So of course, Myanmar is largely a Buddhist country. There are many within the protests, certainly not all, because it's quite diverse in terms of ethnicity and background, but there are many Buddhists that are engaged on the side of the nonviolent protesters. And I think many right now are confronting the purpose of the nonviolence and the ability to maintain it, both in terms of a practical and logistical level, as well as religious and what Buddhism teaches about cause and effect and karma and what and with each action, what will come in this life or a future life in terms of a reaction. And this is all being looked at and calculated, both in terms of the overall desire to want to win, as well as these kind of religious tenets. And so how are you reconciling this within the Buddhism that you brought up, that you were brought up with and that you believe in, as well as how are you seeing other people confront how to examine the need possibly for some kind of retaliation or a change in tactics with some of the religious edicts of Buddhism?
Well, we decided to adopt this non-violence policy because there were a lot of theories when the coup happened. And one theory that we all agree with is this. And there are a lot of proven evidences in history that soft power have the actual power to win against hard power. So so we decided we are going to do this. And another thing is, this is not the first time, the first coup this have happened in our country. So every time something like this happened and military got involved itself in all of these riots and protests and things, they have sort of like a playbook, and they always use the same strategies and tactics whenever they can from this same book. So what they're going to do is they want us to become violent, and they want us to attack them, you know, head on. It's sort of like this is the violence is their power, you know, is their playing field. So they're trying to taunt you and lure you into playing in their home base, in their home team, and they're gonna overpower you with their weapons and their violence and their brutality. So we decided we're going to avoid that at all costs. So that's when the non-violence policy started, and a lot of us agreed with that as well. And you mentioned something about the religion, and yes, when these protests happen, so the world sees Myanmar as really racist and chaotic places. There are a lot of violence and, you know, disagreement between each other, people, persons of different skin color or ethnicities or different religions. The world sort of sees us like this, but what we would like to, what I would like to point out is it's all just a facade, a propaganda that these junta and their political party has been putting out a front so that the world sees us, the international community sees us as the country where, you know, sort of like a violent barbarians people live in. Actually, it's not true. You know, when we're out on the street, all of the protesters have different social backgrounds, different religions, and all of us are just a big crowd in there, supporting each other, helping each other. You may have also seen it on social media when you know things were peaceful. There were a lot of monks, you know, helping out with the Muslim people. You know, Muslim people in a crowd marching down the streets, and you know a lot of other non-Indian looking people are cheering them up, and you know the vice versa. And you may have also seen, you know, other people, you know, people coming out from the mosque to cheer the ongoing crowd, bringing out food to feed us. You know, there were a lot of culturally different, racially different, and religiously different people in here united against this junta, and it has always been true. It's not just because of this incident. It has always been true. We were always supportive of each other. We weren't actually, you know, fighting and killing each other because we pray to a different god or we worship different deities. It's not true. So when you say there are people of Buddhist backgrounds decided to adopt this non-violence policy, it's everyone is the same. You know, Muslim, we have Muslim in there, Hinduans in there, Christian people in there. You know, everyone. We have decided to show the world that we are not violent. We're not what the hunter, you know, picturing us and showing the world as out to be. And another thing is the issue of Rohingya people. You know, especially with regards to Rohingya people, our country as a whole has been put on ICJ, and we have been defending. Dawn San Suu Kyi has been defending the case against these Rohingya genocides on ICJ. And what we would like to say is that we're not defending the junta. What people think is Dawn San Suu Kyi was defending this military who were killing these Rohingya people. It was not so. We're not murderers. We're not violent people. We would never, and we have never agreed or encouraged the military to kill and murder all these people or burn down their villages. No, what Aung San Suu Kyi was doing was she was defending the Myanmar people, not the junta. And during this Rohingya issue, Burmese people, all of us, we were dumb enough to believe the lies and the stories of the junta. We're not saying it to plead to the international community right now, no. So the story from the junta side was, what we knew was Rohingya people started the attack on the Rakhine police officers, and some of the police officers were killed, some of the villagers were burned, and what we felt was, you know, anger and rage and sadness for our people who live in Rakhine. And these Rohingya people were put in the dark so much that none of us Burmese people knew they existed. And junta actually made sure of that. They always keep the news of Rohingya people in the dark. So we never actually knew or heard about Rohingya people before these violence in Rakhine started like 2 or 3 years ago. So the side and the stories from our side were quite different from what the world was seeing. And there were a lot of fake news, and there were a lot of pictures you know, people getting killed in African countries. These pictures are used and, you know, spread fake news by some of the medias, not, you know, famous medias, just on social media everywhere. So people start to get confused, and we don't really know what to do and how to feel anymore. But if we actually knew what Hunter was capable of, like what they're doing right now, we would have, you know, stopped and did everything we could to actually stop all of these ethnic cleansing or genocides of the Rohingya. I'm not saying that to plead to the international community. We are, you know, peaceful people. We are not murderers that the Hunter has set us out to be. This is not us. That's part of the reason why we are adopting this nonviolence strategy even today, even, you know, when the Honda is shooting at us. And, you know, maybe things may change in the future. But what I want to say is this is not who we are in nature.
Right. So you're saying that the killings that the junta initiated to the Rohingya in Rakhine, that they have endeavored to portray this campaign as something that they were not doing alone, but that was a feature of an overall violent attitude among Burmese that was then put out to the world to want to give this kind of imagery that Burmese people are just inherently violent and hateful, and that characterization is something that Burmese feel today is a stain on how the world sees them because of this. But within the country, that many Burmese are feeling now some sense of regret or remorse or even awakening that they got it wrong, that they bought into certain measures of fake news and things spreading on Facebook and propaganda and such, and that they were buying into a story that the military was executing that they're now realizing is very much not true.
Yes,
do I have that right?
Actually, this is the same strategy, you know, the same tactic that Hunter has been using all of these, you know, times. A lot of people may have noticed at the start, you know, everything was peaceful. We were protesting peacefully. They were trying to stop the protester peacefully. And then they have planted spies among us, you know, wearing same as us as a civilian, and tried to rile people up and started throwing stones and, you know, make the protests all chaotic and things. And that is what they did back in 1988. And then, you know, once people become violent and started killing cops, they switch out these cops with soldiers and justify the actions to start killing people. That is what they're doing right now. And it may be too late, but now we realize that that is exactly what they did with Rohingya people. You know, that our side of the story started with Rohingya people attacking the police station in Rakhine. But we are now like 100% sure the story started that way, but we don't know what actually agitated them, what actually taunted them to hate these policemen and this security forces so much that Rohingya people would go to the police station and burn it down and started killing the cops. We don't know what these cops has done to them so badly and so horribly that Rohingya people might retaliate it this way. That is the story that we have been missing, that we miss. And we can't apologize enough that we were dumb enough to believe that story. It is a terrible half-assed story that we knew. We totally missed the first part of it, which is the most important part. We just know you retaliated. And we don't know what actually caused you to do this. So the whole Burmese people, we are sorry. We can't stress this enough, how sorry we are and how sad we are for actually believing this side of the Hunter.
Right. And one of the interesting things that you hear the junta say is that to justify their rule is that they are the only institution capable of unifying and uniting the country behind them. And of course, the ironic feature there is that they're absolutely correct, except they have united the entire country against them. So that's how they've been able to unite the country, not under them, but against them. And you're really seeing the features of a bully. I mean, a bully relies on brute force and strength. A bully is often weak inside or insecure, is not so intelligent or strategic, but is just doing the same strategies over and over and over that just rely on brute force. And the way to meet a bully is to not choose their field of battle, because they're probably going to win with that brute force, but to find some other kind of tactic to engage, which sounds like you're doing in terms of when they're responding with brute force, what the counter response is. And certainly I did see a few weeks ago, it was quite inspiring when you were watching them do those same strategies of inserting agitators into the crowd who look like protesters and then were violent. And then the people around them soon realizing that they were not actually correct protesters and detaining them and not allowing them to do that harm. And then other times they were, you know, famously they sent fake monks. They took criminals and they shaved their heads and they put robes on them and they sent them into neighborhoods to do harm, to poison water and burn down houses. And as someone explained on an earlier podcast, there was a hope that the residents might be so angered by what happened that they would abuse and beat these fake monks. And then there would be images that would soon spread of residents looking like they were, you know, lay residents that were looking like they were beating and harming monks and members of the Sangha. And that would decrease the support overall of the protest movement in CDM. Of course, that didn't happen. They detained these monks without harming them. They just did what they could to be able to handcuff them with whatever rope or something they had. And those images never got out because they did not fall. You guys did not fall into that trap of responding with violence, as many people would in situations that were that terrible and terrifying. And you're also describing how this nonviolent attitude is coming from a number of different backgrounds. It's coming from one, just being smart in terms of how you deal with bullies and how you deal with specific bullies who have a certain track record going back previous years and decades. So that's one reason why the nonviolent strategy is being engaged. Another is that you simply can't win with whatever violence would bring to bear, whatever rage one would want of going and attacking these armed forces, you're not going to win. So it's just strategy. Another reason is this realization that you have been characterized as a brutal, violent people, and by, ironically enough, by actions that the military was the one that did and spread that propaganda. And so you're not engaging in that violence to be able to try to change that narrative. And from other conversations I've had on the podcast with practitioners, with protesters that have come from a deeply Buddhist and meditative background, they've also referenced parts of the religion, parts of the teachings, why they're engaging the way they are. So there's a number of reasons why this background of nonviolent protest has been occurring up to this point, although some do think we're at a breaking point, and we could very well be past that breaking point by the time this podcast comes out. Every day is changing so much on the ground. So we don't know what the future is going to bring, but we do know where we are now. So at this juncture in time, with how you're feeling, where do you think we are at the current state of the nonviolent movement? Do you think it can or should be sustained? And if not, what do you feel the next step should or might be for whatever you're comfortable in sharing? Obviously, there's certain things that you would not want to share about certain planning or preparation going on. But for whatever you're comfortable sharing, where do you think we're at in terms of the nonviolent movement?
Well, to be perfectly honest, we are, it seems to be that it's a bit past this point of nonviolence, but we are somewhat trying to retain this nonviolent strategy. We're not, you know, starting the offensive just yet. There's this timing that we're all waiting for, because we have to be clever about this, because it's not the colonial days where you use a musket to shoot at people. No, this is the submachine guns and machine guns we're talking about. These we're going up against people who are not afraid to bomb us if they wanted to, without the help or pressure from the international community. They have been also, you know, using a lot of air supports and bombing the crap out of all the Kachin and Chin people in the past too, during the Civil War, or what they call a Civil War. So we have to be clever about this. We can't just go up and start the offensive just yet. So CRPH and Dr. Sasa have already told us and the international community that we have the right to defend ourselves. But of course, there's even today, there's a debate still going on how much of a degree that we can defend ourselves. So we are trying to defend ourselves by setting up barricades in each and every single street that we can think of to halt their advances, so that night raids happens less than before, so that, you know, they just can drive their truck into a street and grab whatever people they want to go, and then ask the parents to come pick up the body the very next day. And even as of today, a lot of these cases has been happening, not a lot less than before, but it is still happening. So we are not going to keep up this non-violence for long. And we already had rumors and news that the hunter, we have on 27 March, we have Armed Force Day, or you know, in the honor of Damodar, Armed Force Day coming up. And we have heard news that the hunter has ordered all of his security forces to complete this coup by the end of March, or before this Armed Force Day happens. Maybe he wants to put out a statement on that special day of his, I guess. So if violence from their side will be escalating pretty soon. And even yesterday, there were a lot of shootings and uses of machine guns and submachine guns in what seems to be Aungbinle and Dongji. So we are past the point of nonviolence to a degree, but we're still defending. We are still defending. We are not going to attack just yet. It's not like a barbarian, but we are adapting all of the strategies to defend ourselves by the use of shields and some weapons and slingshots and things that we can find. And what we're waiting for is the timing, because if we have to, you know, play an offensive, we have to be united. Because all we don't really have guns. What we have is the strength in number, just, you know, people with very basic weaponry like swords and slingshots. So it's just the timing that we are waiting for. And Dr. Sasa has also warned us that we have to defend ourselves, defend our lives with whatever we can find. So this is what we're doing right now. And we're not really sure how long we can keep this up.
Right, right. And I want to ask a follow-up question based on that. That's personal again, because you've described overall in the movement where people stand with nonviolence and the strategy and where we might be moving to. And I assume that you, like me, has probably very seldom, if ever, gotten to any kind of fight or alteration, you know, even going back to early childhood years, you know, more than just kind of pushing people in the schoolyard or something. And being, both of us being adults now, I am growing up and living in civilized society according to certain conventions and rules. The idea of committing, planning violence against another individual, carrying that out, seeing the effect by one's own hand, I imagine it's unimaginable for most of us coming from that background. And yet you're in a situation where what was not so long ago unimaginable now becomes a serious reality to consider. So internally and personally, how are you managing to reconcile that possible shift and transformation?
Personally, I can't say for sure yet, though, but Because I'm a doctor, and I'm not talking about oats or anything. You know, oats are out of the window now with people like these. So what I'm talking about is I am a medical personnel, so my combat ability on the front lines are very limited, if I may say so. But a lot of the doctors like us, we have decided to go up to the front line if that's what is needed of us. Whether or not we can actually, you know, harm or harm somebody up to the point of killing them is yet to be seen. But a lot of the doctors and a lot of the peoples are very angry right now. I'm not sure if it is intention, if it is, you know, being taunted intentionally by the hunter or things, but at a lot of the news you may have seen today that a 15 years old kid were shot and died on the spot while he was fetching a snack for his mother. Today there are a lot of news like these, and you may have heard that an engineer kid was arrested during the nightfall and asked to get his body back the very next morning. So yes, we are not above killing anyone now. We could, and you may have seen one of the article written by one of a respected surgeon. We all respect the surgeon. He said, if I can save a lot more people by putting down my scalpel and picking up a gun and start shooting, I would. And that was his word. And I would say all of us are feeling exactly like that right now. So if we can save a lot of people by picking up a gun and, you know, dropping down, putting down a stetho or syringe or whatever the hell we are holding right now, we would. That's we're at the boiling point right now. So personally, that is what I am feeling right now, even though when the real time comes, whether or not if I'm capable of that is yet to be seen.
I want to go back to what you said a little bit ago. You were describing just the cruelty of this military and of the, beating people to death, aiming for the head, targeting medics, all these other kinds of real egregious breaks, even in wartime conventions. And I want to ask you what might be somewhat of an unfair question. It's certainly one that I wouldn't know how to approach or answer, but I'm curious what your thoughts are on it because you've been faced with this day after day. And so you've certainly have had to try to understand the madness and the senselessness of it. And that question is, why are they doing this? Why are these professional military giving and following orders to target and terrorize their own people? How do you make any sense out of what is going on if you can make sense of it?
From the top of my head, I think it's because of the institution and how the military was formed. I think the long history of army and the core of it was the fascism. It's long in the history, but this modern military, the army, was formed by General Aung San during the English colonial age, when General Aung San had and his 30 trusted men had to went to Japan to learn the ways of war and started forming the army, and they were learning this way of war. While Japan was still adopting fascism. So, if you really think about it, in the core, the heart of our military, or not our, this military, junta military, is the fascism. And another thing is the common knowledge to everyone in our country that how their institution actually operates. They have this hierarchy things that the seniors, whatever your seniority is during the institution. For example, since I'm a medical school, I'm going to give you the military medical school as an example. It is called a DSMA. I don't really know the long form is. So in this medical institution of the military, it's common knowledge that the senior can actually in their word, quote unquote, punish their juniors in any way that they can if they see, you know, if they deem fit. And this form of punishment can be, you know, anything. Like it could be physically brutalizing each other, like a simple form of, hey, you there, just, you know, drop down and give me 50, to like brutalizing, like punching them in the face or wherever they want. And this punishment, this brutalizing and bullying were so severe at some point that some of the juniors actually die from this beating up from the seniors. And these seniors actually got away with actually murdering someone and bullying someone. And that's how these institutions actually operate. You know, if the juniors die from getting beat up, and that is it, they don't really, you know, take consequences for their action. Maybe they get the detention for like a week or something, sometimes even less. They got away with even less, even if they brutalize or bullying somebody to the point that somebody died. So this brutality coming from the people with institutions and mindsets like that, it's not really that surprising, if you ask me. So, and another thing is, even on social media nowadays, like there's two worlds torn apart on social media. Us people who are trying to revolve and, you know, go through this revolution, and there are people, you know, with their military background or people who openly or secretly supporting the army, they think this coup is the right thing to do, and this hunter and the military is actually saving the country from falling into the wrong hands. And by, you know, in order to do that, they think firing at people, you know, shooting people is the necessary thing to do. You can even hear some of it on some of the video clips that are online right now, that whenever they arrested or capture somebody, there's, especially, you know, actually dispersed the doctors' protests in Yangon. When they arrested a lot of the young kids there, you know, medical students there, you can even hear it in the video clips. Like, they were like, okay, so you doctor, you stupid doctor, in his word, you stupid doctor started this thing. That's why people started this nonsense CDM movement. So you guys are responsible for it. So if you do something stupid again, I'm going to shoot you. And I am doing this for your sake. You know, for your own good. And I'm doing this because you guys get out of line. So in order to get you back into the line, we are not hesitate to shoot you. And some of the soldiers even say, we are here to shoot you and get you into line. And I came all the way from Rakhine State to do this. They were openly saying that they were so proud of the fact that they're actually, you know, shooting at people gives them some sort of pleasure or something like that. It's like, he was proudly saying, I came all the way back from Rakhine, where I was deployed, to this big city and shooting at you to get you back into line. They were so proud of saying that. And that is the kind of that the people and the soldiers that we are dealing with here. And even on the social medias, the people who support the military, they also support the fact that it is fair to kill people, shoot at us. And what, in their words, what they say is, if you don't go out on the street, you're not going to get shot. You get shot. People are getting shot at and dying because you go out on the street. So if you don't want to die, don't go out on the street. It is that simple. And they're openly saying it on the social media. It's so horrible.
Right. And of course, that's not true, because people are being shot while staying in their own homes, and they're being shot by going to buy groceries. But, you know, still, I think it's so valuable what we're saying, that we have to understand the mentality of the other side. To just stand back and demonize them and look at it from our perspective, as true as that seems, we're not really going to get somewhere until we understand why it's making sense to them, no matter how twisted it is. We have to make that effort. And that's what I appreciate that you're doing here. You're describing this institutional culture borrowed from Tojo's Imperial Japanese Army in World War II, which trained the founders of the Tatmadaw, which is a institutional culture that you're describing still exists today, not only among soldiers, but also even among medical staff within the military, of seniors that are able to freely haze and even encourage abuse of juniors, and people within that institution that are not just allowed and permitted, but actually encouraged as a kind of value or virtue of the institution to abuse, although we would use that word, they might not, those that are not, quote unquote, in line, that are outside of that institution. And so you're describing this this mindset that is really difficult to understand, but appreciate trying to bring it there for our examination, of believing that they have to actually beat people to death and shoot people in the head and terrorize, and that in their minds, somehow this is bringing some kind of good to the country. Right. So I don't even know where to begin, how to make sense of that. I guess I'll follow that up with, I preface this by saying my previous question was unfair, and maybe my next question will be even more unfair, but you did so well with the first one. See how you can do with this one. Is, you know, this platform, podcast, before the coup, we traditionally focused more on Buddhist topics, on meditation, on Burmese Buddhism, tracing people's spiritual journeys in the country, foreigner as well as Burmese monastic, including lay as well. And so we still have a wide range of audience that are coming from a practitioner base. And one of the things that is so confusing to them, especially foreign practitioners that are engaged in Vipassana meditation or Buddhist practice or ordination of some kind, is how can a country that is so steeped in Buddhist practice and belief, and that has had meditation masters from the 19th and 20th centuries that have really inspired and propelled the entire mindfulness and meditation movements that we're seeing today all over the West. This all came from Myanmar, from these great teachers that many of whom in the current generation are still living and teaching today. How can this country that is so steeped in Buddhist ideals give rise to a military, which is pretty much top to bottom all throughout Buddhist? Certainly the top leadership would identify as Buddhist, however they interpret that as meaning, whatever strain of their Buddhism is. But in describing this institutional culture that you have, how is it reconciled with a Buddhist belief of leadership and of soldiers, when it seems like the contrast between this could never be greater?
Well, I think there's sort of like an old saying in this military, is that killing people while you're trying to protect your country and its constitution is the right thing to do. It's not a sin. In Burmese, what is called jebo de dong ye mla, which roughly translate to as, if you die as a soldier while protecting your country, you will never go to hell. So I think they sort of believe that kind of thing whenever they go out on the battlefield. And another thing is, we used to have two biggest political power and political party in Myanmar, which is NLD, our democratically elected people. And another thing is USDP, and these are mostly funded, and people with only military backgrounds or military supporters are in these political party. Everyone knows that, and their basic selling points, you know, whenever they're going on a campaign, even with the first election, their basic selling point is that military is actually protecting the religious and the religion and the culture and the constitution of the country. They mostly pinpoint the fact that Aung San Suu Kyi's husband is not of Burmese blood. She's married to a foreigner, and the propaganda, whenever the propaganda that you can hear from, is that because of us people letting someone with a foreigner as my husband to become a president or meta president or a state counselor, we are pushing the country over the edge, and we are breaking the country apart. We are throwing away the culture and the bloodline, and the Buddhism would fall apart in the hands of the foreigners. You might even see on the cover of the Time magazines that the face of Buddhist terror, you know, who were to face, and like 4 or 5 years back. And that's how they spread their propaganda. That's their selling point. So if you, they openly said that if you vote for NLD, you are throwing the country into the trash. You are destroying the bloodlines. You are destroying the religion. And a lot of the people, really care about the Buddhism, even though only half of us actually understand what it is and what it represents. But you know, when you use propaganda and fake news like that, some of the people actually believe it. And these soldiers and the people who's supporting the military, they actually seems to believe this propaganda that if we let NLD and Aung San Suu Kyi become a meta president, or if we let them become the head of the state, then the religion, the Buddhism, would actually fall apart. She's going to start bringing in the foreigners from all over the country, the Rohingya, you know, and all the foreigners. And people even say Aung San Suu Kyi was using Sean Tunnell as her economical advisor. So they were actually pointing it out. See, foreigners are coming in now, and they're going to take up all the resources and start selling the country to whatever to other countries, and everything's going to fall apart. And military has the power to prevent it, as that's their selling point.
Right, that's the propaganda that they're giving. But of course, when we see the military in charge, I think some would argue, with much evidence to support it, that the military itself is one of the greatest threats to Burmese Buddhism at present, to the entire sasana. We're seeing Buddha statues that are riddled with bullets. We're seeing monks that are imprisoned or silenced or sometimes killed now, as well as in 2007. We're seeing pagoda funds and monasteries that are raided to be able to get the cash. And on and on. We're seeing teachings themselves that are being perverted through superstition and through astrology that have no connection to the scriptures. And so while this kind of mythology is given that they're the institution that can protect Buddhism, simultaneously, they're engaging in daily actions that are showing it to be the single greatest living threat to Burmese Buddhism, at least in my opinion. And so is that reality getting through to people? Because propaganda is a very, very insidious thing. And once a propaganda message gets instilled in someone's mind, it can literally prevent the reality of the news coming in. I mean, we see that in my country. We've seen it in the last 5 years of Trump in startling degrees, that once some degree of propaganda is believed, then an alternative set of facts and reality supplant that and superimpose on that. And even when the actual things that are happening around one in the country, they are minimized or dismissed or interpreted in different ways. So my question for you is, as the military is holding this propaganda while simultaneously engaging in actions that show it as the greatest danger to the thing that it's reportedly trying to protect, is that reality getting through to people and that propaganda breaking down, or is it being held up based on the strength of that messaging over many, many years?
I think they are trying to ignore the fact that military is actually destroying the Buddhism that we also preciously held on to. And they're actually brutalizing monks, and they have been raiding, yes, monasteries and pagodas for the cash grab. And as of today, we have been getting rumors that the Shwedagon pagoda, which is one of the treasure of our country, has been being stripped off. The gold on the pagoda has been being stripped off as of now. And these military supporters are actually buying the stories that the military, the hunter, is still telling. The word of the junta, they're just actually, you know, quote unquote, borrowing money and this gold from the pagoda in order to save the country. Now, after everything's become peaceful, they are bound to give up with interest, quote and unquote, in their words. So it's actually shocking to see that these supporters are still believing in these fairy tales that these Honda has been telling. And they're still, some of them are ignoring the fact that they are brutalizing the monks, and they have actually arrested some of the monks in Dongji and stripping him of his monk status and putting him in court and in jail. They are still spreading fake news as well, that they're even telling that these monks are not real monks. They are just actors and spies that that us, you know, the people from this size are hired, are hiring to act as a monk or a nun or a priest, in fact. And even though we people on the social media try to explain the real story to them, they just won't listen. And they just believe the fact that these are not real monks. These are just hired actors. And the hunter is not stealing money from the pagodas, or they're not raiding the place. They're just borrowing the money. And when everything is said and done, they are going to, you know, pay back the pagoda in interest. And they still believe that fact. And it's really appalling that they still believe these fairy tales these hunter has been telling.
Right. So there's some segment of the population there, just as there is in my country with some of the fantasies we see on the extreme right, that no matter what the military possibly engages in, and no matter how egregious it is, the propaganda that they've drunk very deeply from will prevent them from ever seeing past what they want to ascribe to the military's intentions. And they're not going to get beyond that. And that is the power of propaganda to at least some segment, hopefully a smaller segment of a population that believes that hook, line, and sinker. So we've been talking a bit about the military and the military supporters. How about the monks? And I know that there's a lot of monks in the country, and there's a lot of different types of traditions and types of monasteries that are engaged in different activities and teachings. So we can't say a blanket statement, this is how the monks feel. It's obviously not monolithic, and we're seeing things across the board. But can you give us like a general temperature check-in of what you're seeing and hearing about the monastic response in the past 6 weeks?
Most of the monasteries and monks has been peaceful, and as a lot of them has actually taken the side that is, in their words, rightful and truthful. And they have actually joined the revolution. And the top monks, the professors, have actually joined and actually announced that they have joined the CDM movement against the will of the junta. And but before everything was peaceful, in Yangon, there were a lot of monks who were actually giving away foods and watermelons and juices to all of the walking or sitting protester or walking by protester. They were helping out in every way that they can. They were actually giving away food, cooking food for us. And there were a lot of religious things too, like chanting, and we have this, I don't know what's the English word for it. It's, you know, a datan where you vow that you are going to chant, or you're going to do these things for like a designated set of days. So this a datan for chanting this mantra of love, mitato, for like 1,000 times or something, and praying that the protester would be safe and peaceful. And they say the right, they always pray for the truthful, the right side to win, and the justice must prevail. That's how they have been joining. And in Mandalay, it's more than that. not just, you know, giving away, giving out food or helping the protester. Monks has been seen out on the street, like walking and holding signs that they do not accept a military coup, and they want Aung San Suu Kyi to be freed again, and they want a democracy to be back in their country. They have been walking down the streets. You know, there were like hundreds of monks peacefully protesting out in the streets of Mandalay and Taungji and a lot of the other cities and places as well.
Right, so you have some of the higher level monks who have taken a very public stand, an ethical stand to resist the government takeover. And then you have other monks engaging in everything from doing chanting and taking an aditan to chant a certain length of time or a certain number of times, and some that are going on to protest. What has been the response for this? Oh, and then I should also mention we have you have monks that are giving food to the protester. This is a complete reverse of what usually happens with protesters giving food to the monks. I saw someone online refer to this as rivers are running upstream. And so we have all these different types of engagement that the monastic community is taking. What has been the response from the military for these kind of engagements with monks? And have the monks also been putting themselves at risk, or do they have any protection from the spiritual commitment that they've made and by wearing the robes?
As far as I know, not so much actually. Aside from be getting shot at, some of the monks have been welcomed with tear gas while they were trying to stop the security forces from harming or shooting at the protester. This I think that was I forgot the name of the Seattle. He was arrested, stripped off all the monk status, and has been put in jail, and now will be put in court with Penal Code 505. Which is defaming of the dignity of the hunter or something. It's roughly translated to that. Yes, and the thing is, if you are charged with a 505A, you can bail out of the jail. It's one of the political penal code that this dictator has been using time and again in order to keep the political prisoners in prison forever. Some of the monks has been detained, and these top monks who have declared and has taken this ethical stance and joining the CDM movement, we have heard rumors that they have been put under house arrest, or monastic arrest in this case. So that's how the hunter has responded actually, and they even try to win the favor of some of the military supporters from the monks by trying to give COVID vaccines to some of the monks as well. And I don't think they've been winning any hearts at all by doing so.
Right. So basically, they're silencing some of these top monks who have spoken out and taking away their platform from being able to speak further. And the status of some of the most revered monks right now is unknown, exactly what's going on with them. Looking on the other side, have there been monks who have been supportive of the military takeover? And how has that support been voiced? Or what kinds of actions have we seen to show that support, and what can you say about why they would lean on that side?
We've heard rumors. Those news are unconfirmed because right now the monks and the people who are supporting the military are not doing so openly right now because they're scared of social punishment. So they're doing so in secret, or they would just say they are neutral. You know, they're if someone says they're taking a neutral stance in a time like this, it's pretty sure they're taking the military side. So what we have is unconfirmed rumors that Didigusiado have been supporting the military side. And we have information to somehow believe that is because there there was news on the social media that monks from the Didigu monastery has been joining the night protests while protesting out on the streets in front of the Didigu monastery with candles in their hands and praying, aka joining the night protests. They have been doing so, and once the news got popular enough, they actually get back with this explanation that these monks are not actually from the Didigu monastery. These are just regular monks from other monastery who just happens to do the night protest in front of the Didigu monastery. So in a way, it's like the Didigu Siado is taking a neutral stance, and he's not actually joining the hunter or supporting the revolution. So in that way, I think he's supporting the junta in that way, I guess.
Right. And traditionally in Burmese Buddhist society, there's kind of this firewall between the lay supporters and the monastic community, living very separate lives. There's a reciprocal quality, but there's also very separate worlds in terms of their responsibilities and communities and how they're engaged. And in particular, the lay community is very hesitant to want to offer any judgment of or criticism or critique of how monks are doing their business. It's considered unseemly. It's considered bad karma. It's considered something that the monastic side should work out themselves, and the lay side is just there to support them and to gain merit by offering them things and by listening to their discourses, by learning spiritual guidance under them, but certainly never to be so arrogant as to think that one should criticize or offer judgment to someone from the monastic community. But we're living in very, very different times now, and it is literally a matter of life and death in terms of where, even though the monastic community is charged with not engaging in worldly affairs, they've renounced the world according to their religious vows, they do have some kind of moral and ethical stand that they can make at this time, should they choose to. And so what are you seeing of that traditional relationship between lays and monastics? Is that traditional belief in karma and in the respect that lay should have towards monastics, that they should refrain from engaging in any kind of critiques, is that still holding true today? Or have circumstances changed so fast and so rapidly that some lays are being a bit more courageous and having a bit more agency and critical thought in being able to express their disappointment on one hand or their appreciation on the other of how different monks or monasteries are engaging at this time?
It's a really hard question. I don't really know how to answer that. But there are some like really famous, or I would say, a really old monks who have actually renounced the world and has been living in the jungle, like really secluded places, and meditating years long. So there are actually monks like that, and one in particular is Mindful Seado. He has actually renounced the world, and he has not taken any side. He's like complete neutral, and he never showed any appreciation for the hunter or this size, but what he said was just, it's sad to see that people are killing each other in this time of age. And that was his remark, and that was it. And what I'm trying to say is there are monks like this who take like complete neutral stance, whatever the case is, whatever the issue is, whatever is going on in the world. There's some monks who have renounced all of it, so never take part in any of that. But what we're discussing right now, for example, with Didigu Seado, he is taking neutral stance right now. But in the past, there were a lot of things that he did that prove that he has not renounced the world of these things and these issues. He has actually meddled in a lot of the things, like he's trying to make peace when the Rohingya Rohingya, atrocity was going on, and there was a lot of hate between the Buddhist people and the Muslims in the world and in the country as well. He has time from time openly said that how he support how he appreciate that military is still protecting the religious stance of the people, and how the military is actually still protecting the religious stance, and they're doing so courageously, something like that. So when he said those things in the past, directly or indirectly, and now he is taking a neutral stance, so in my opinion, it's somehow conflicting to his ideals or something.
Right. So there's a lot more questions I could ask you, but we are literally running at the very end of your internet capability there, because, and probably also your own health, because you've had one long day after another, and you've been so kind to stay up until 5 minutes before 1 a.m. when your internet is about to shut off and you're about to go to bed to prepare for another day. You actually referenced that you were supposed to be on night watch tonight. This is something that everyone has to do, unfortunately, in your community now, to protect your community against the military incursions that can come at any time. But you were able to trade your slot to be able to come and join us. So really appreciate you being able to do that and share your voice and use this platform to give your perspective. Before we close out, I would just like to offer you a chance to be able to express whatever you would like to the foreign community that's listening in, especially a question that many of them have, which is, what can they do now? Many people listening feel quite helpless, quite concerned about what's going on, but from the safety and the freedom of their own homes and their own countries, don't necessarily know what they can do or how they can engage. So how would you speak to that? For those that are caring about this, what can they do that would make a difference in the struggle for freedom that you and others are leading right now?
I would answer that with the same answer that I always giving, and all of us are always giving the same answer. That is that every little bit helps. Even your voice, like speaking out for the truth, and every little voice help, and even if it's financially or raising awareness in your area or in your neighborhood or in your community, it's just one voice right now. But if you do speak up and raise awareness, a lot of people will start joining and give, for example, Korea right now, they have been raising a lot of awareness, because we are in the same page of history that they were once used to be in. They were raising a lot of awareness. There were a lot of presentations and stories and on street protesting and praying for Myanmar to gain back democracy in South Korea. So you can do something like that too. So don't feel helpless. You know, sometimes, you know, leave that to us. So please do speak out, and because by speaking out for us, you can actually pressure the international community, and it has a really a damaging effect on the junta and his connection, because right now he's trying to run the country. There's nobody accepting it, so he can't really run it, and we're pretty sure he's broke right now, so because he's, you know, actually stealing golds and monies from the pagoda. So what we're trying is to cut off all the heads of this snake. So what you can actually do is try to pressure the international communities and the oil companies and, you know, other business companies to stop their connection at all, any kind of connection, you know, cut off all the connections with the junta, so that we actually have the chance of winning this. So every time you speak out, every time, you know, somebody stop trading with the junta, you are actually stopping these people from buying the bullets that are killing his own people. So please do speak out, keep an eye on us, and just like we are predicting, the next 7 days, this week will be the darkest of us all, because by 27, the Armed Force Day in our country, we have heard rumors that the junta will, you know, try to finish his coup, will try to successfully complete this coup. So the brutality and the cruelty will be escalating soon. and he is not above cutting off all the internet connections again. So please do speak up, keep an eye on us, and let me remind you that no news is bad news for us. So if we go like radio silent and there's no more news from us, please try to look out for us. And we really appreciate it in this time of need.
Yeah, those are powerful words. And we definitely encourage those listening, if you found this interview and other interviews like this valuable, please share them to your networks. Please inform your local communities so that more people can be informed. So much of the help that you can do is just simply being informed and knowing what's happening. That's so much of the battle right there. Beyond that, as Coco has said, if you are able to petition local companies or politicians, if you're able to give a donation after this interview, we'll be giving information about how you can donate to get it directly to the needs of Coco's team and what he's doing, as well as the overall CDM movement. And also not to underestimate emotional support. As much as you can just make your voice heard that you are standing with the people that are struggling for freedom with their backs against the wall, not feeling any support from anywhere, just knowing that somewhere in some distant place that they are in your camp, that they have your back, even if it's virtually, that can mean a tremendous amount as well. So with that, Coco, I are minutes away from your internet being shut off. Really appreciate the time that you've taken. It's just been extraordinary to hear from you. And be safe and be well, and we're with you.
Okay. Thanks, everyone. And thanks for the listener. And thanks for giving me the chance to, you know, speak my mind here.
After today's discussion, it should be clear to everyone just how dire the situation is in Myanmar. We are doing our best to shine a light on the ongoing crisis, and we thank you for taking the time to listen. If you found today's talk of value, please consider passing it along to friends in your network. And because our nonprofit is now in a position to transfer funds directly to the protest movement, please also consider letting others know that there is now a way to give that supports the most vulnerable, and to those who are especially impacted by this organized state terror. If you would like to join in our mission to support those in Myanmar who are resisting the military coup, we welcome your contribution in any form, currency, or transfer method. Every cent goes immediately and directly to funding those local communities who need it most. Donations go to support such causes as the Civil Disobedience Movement, CDM, families of deceased victims, and the purchasing of protective equipment and medical supplies. Or if you prefer, you can earmark your donation to go directly to the guest you just heard on today's show. In order to facilitate this donation work, we have registered a new nonprofit called Better Burma for this express purpose. Any donation you give on our Insight Myanmar website is now directed to this fund. Alternatively, you can visit our new Better Burma website, which is betterburma.org, and donate directly there. In either case, your donation goes to the same cause, and both websites accept credit cards. You can also give via PayPal by going to paypal.me/betterburma. Additionally, we can take donations through Patreon, Venmo, GoFundMe, and Cash App. Simply search Better Burma on each platform and you'll find our account. You can also visit either website for specific links to those respective accounts or email us at info@betterburma.org. In all cases, that's Better Burma, one word, spelled BETTERBURMA. If you would like to give in another way, please contact us. Thank you so much for your kind consideration. You've been listening to the Insight Myanmar podcast. We'd appreciate it very much if you could rate, review, and or share this podcast. Every little bit of feedback helps. You can also subscribe to the Insight Myanmar podcast on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Stitcher, or wherever else you get your podcasts to make sure you don't miss any of our upcoming episodes. If you can't find our feed on your podcast player, please just let us know and we'll ensure it can be offered there in the future. Also, make sure to check out our website for a list of our complete episodes, including additional text, videos, and other information available at insightmyanmar.org. And I also invite you to take a look at our new nonprofit organization at betterburma.org. There was certainly a lot to talk about in this episode, and we'd like to encourage listeners to keep the discussion going. make a post, request specific questions, and join in on discussions currently going on the Insight Myanmar podcast Facebook group. You're also most welcome to follow our Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter accounts by the same name. If you're not on social media, feel free to message us directly at info@insightmyanmar.org. Or if you'd like to start up a discussion group on another platform, let us know and we can share that forum here. Finally, we're open to suggestions about guests or topics for future episodes. So if you have someone or something in mind, please do be in touch. We would like to take this time to thank everyone who made this podcast possible. Currently, our team consists of two sound engineers, Mike Bink and Martin Combs. There's, of course, Zach Hessler, content collaborator and part-time co-host. Ken Pransky helps with editing, and a special Mongolian volunteer who is asked to remain anonymous does our social media templates. In light of the ongoing crisis in Myanmar, a number of volunteers have stepped in to lend a hand as well, and so we'd like to take this time to appreciate their effort in our time of need. And we're always on the lookout for more volunteers during this critical time, so if you'd like to contribute, definitely let us know. We'd also like to thank everyone who has assisted us in arranging for the guests we've interviewed so far. And of course, we send a big thank you to the guests themselves for agreeing to come on and share such personal, powerful stories. Finally, we're immensely grateful for the donors who made this entire thing possible. We want to remind our listeners that the opinions expressed by our guests are their own and don't necessarily reflect the host or other podcast contributors. Please also note that as we are mainly a volunteer team, we do not have the capacity to fact-check our guest interviews. By virtue of being invited on our show, there's a trust that they will be truthful and not misrepresent themselves or others. If you have any concerns about the statements made on this or other shows, please contact us. This recording is the exclusive right of Insight Myanmar Podcast and may not be used without the expressed written permission of the podcast owner, which includes video, audio, written transcripts, or excerpts of any episodes. Also not meant to be used for commercial purposes. On the other hand, we're very open to collaboration. So if you have a particular idea in mind for sharing any of our podcasts or podcast-related information, please feel free to contact us with your proposal. If you would like to support our mission, we welcome your contribution. During this time of crisis, all donations now go towards supporting the protest movement in Myanmar through our new nonprofit, Better Burma. You may give by searching Better Burma on PayPal, Venmo, Cash App, GoFundMe, and Patreon, as well as via credit card at betterburma.org/donation. You can also give right on our Insight Myanmar website, as all donations given there are directed towards the same fund. And with that, we're off to work on the next show, so see you next episode. Yeah.